Why do you think it's appropriate to invite Russia to the G7, given that they've meddled in the 2016 election? And are you worried that if Russia does come to the G7, that it might hurt you politically because it's only going to be a couple months before the 2020 election?
I don't care politically. I really don't. A lot of people don't understand this. I ran one election and I won. Happened to be for president. I don't care politically. I'm going to run another election. I think I'm winning based on polls that we see. Whether I win or not, I have to do the right thing. So I don't do things for political reasons. Really, it was a President Obama. I'm not blaming him, but a lot of bad things happened with President Putin and President Obama. One of the things that happened was, as you know, what happened in with a very big area, a very, very big and important area in the Middle East where the red line was drawn, and then President Obama decided that he was not going to do anything about it. You can't draw red lines in the sand. You just can't do it. And the other was in Ukraine, having to do with a certain section of Ukraine that you know very well, where it was sort of taken away from President Obama. Not taken away from President Trump, taken away from President Obama. President Obama was not happy that this happened because it was embarrassing to him, right? It was very embarrassing to him. And he wanted Russia to be out of the what was called the G8. And that was his determination. He was outsmarted by Putin. He was outsmarted. President Putin outsmarted President Obama. Wait a minute. I'm only thinking about the world, and I'm thinking about this country in terms of the G7, whether it's G7, G8. I think it would be better to have Russia inside the tent than outside the tent. Do we live either way? Yes, we live either way. Is it politically popular for me to say that? Possibly not. I think a lot of people would agree with me, frankly, but possibly not. I do nothing for politics. I know a lot of you aren't going to, you're going to smile at that. I do nothing for politics. I do what's right. And people like what I do. But I just do what's right. And I say, how does that work?
A misleading statement that Russia outsmarted President Obama.
Well, he did.
Other countries have said that the reason why Russia was kicked out was very clearly because they annexed Crimea. Why keep repeating what some people would see as a clear lie?
Well, it was annexed during President, I know you like President Obama, but it was annexed during President Obama's term. If it was annexed during my term, I'd say, sorry, folks, I made a mistake, or sorry, folks. President Obama was helping Ukraine. Crimea was annexed during his term. President Obama was pure and simply outsmarted. They took Crimea during his term. That was not a good thing. It could have been stopped. Could have been stopped with the right whatever. It could have been stopped. But President Obama was unable to stop it, and it's too bad.
This is Trump apparently making the moral argument for Russia joining the G7, that this isn't a political decision, it's simply the right thing to do. And to be clear, what we're talking about here is readmitting the country that illegally invaded and then annexed Crimea before launching a full-scale cyber attack on our own elections. So clearly, rewarding Russia is the right thing to do. But what his response in the clip shows is that Trump truly believes that Obama is to blame for Russia's annexation of Crimea, and sees no irony whatsoever in the fact that Obama took action against Russia, imposing sanctions, expelling 35 diplomats from the US and closing two Russian diplomatic compounds in Maryland, agreeing to kick Russia out of the then G8, and even himself warning Putin against meddling, all while Trump's national security advisor Mike Flynn discussed lifting sanctions on Russia, while Trump moved to return the compounds to the Russians, while Trump advocated for Russia's readmission to the G7, while Trump sided with Putin over our own intelligence agencies regarding Russian meddling. The hypocrisy is just incredible, that Trump thinks that the fact that Putin committing illegal acts during Obama's tenure puts Obama at fault, while completely ignoring the fact that Trump removed any and all punishment for what happened. Did anyone blame FDR for World War II? Of course not. But had FDR's successor gone in and sided with Hitler over our own intel community and pardoned the Nazis guilty of war crimes? See where I'm going with this? Trump might think that his backwards elementary school logic makes sense, but literally no one thought Putin was looking to outsmart Obama by annexing Crimea. They do, however, think that Putin outsmarted Trump by convincing him to do their bidding on a daily basis. And look, Trump projecting his own shortcomings onto others is nothing new. After Trump leveled a racist attack on four non-white congresswomen, he then tweeted that the squad were the real racists. After the intelligence community found that Russia helped Republicans win, Trump claimed that they were trying to help the Democrats win. After he led the attack against Obamacare, Trump claimed that the Democrats are trying to take away coverage from pre-existing conditions. If you want to know something that Trump is guilty of, just look out for him blaming someone else, because 10 times out of 10, it's just a really, really obvious defense mechanism. And here's a pro tip, just because it works on Eric doesn't mean it's gonna work on the rest of us. By the way, Trump might claim that he does nothing for politics, but his entire tenure as president has been solely fueled by politics. He's been holding campaign rallies since December of 2016, before he even took office. Post-inauguration, he started holding rallies in February 2017, not even a month into his term. He hasn't stopped campaigning for a day. He pandered to farmers with two payouts totaling $28 billion to compensate for his trade war with China, despite supposedly being against socialism. He's pandered to evangelicals about the Bible, despite being frighteningly clueless about it.
Okay. You mentioned the Bible. You've been talking about how it's your favorite book. And you said, I think last night in Iowa, some people are surprised that you say that. I'm wondering what one or two of your most favored Bible verses are.
Well,
and why.
I wouldn't want to get into it because to me that's very personal. You know, when I talk about the Bible, it's very personal. So I don't want to get into
verse that means a lot to you that you think about or cite.
The Bible means a lot to me, but I don't want to get into specifics.
Even to cite a verse that you like.
No, I don't want to do that.
You're an Old Testament guy or a New Testament guy?
Probably equal. I think it's just an incredible, the whole Bible is an incredible. I joke very much so. They always hold up the Art of the Deal. I say my second favorite book of all time. But I just think the Bible is just something very special.
The list goes on and on. Trump might claim that he doesn't do what's politically convenient, but we've never had a more politically motivated president in modern history. The guy couldn't even manage to not praise neo-Nazis in Charlottesville, so let's not pretend that Trump's done one single thing that would turn even one person in his base against him as if he's exhibited some moral authority or courage. The fact is that there's no argument whatsoever for Russia to be readmitted into the G7, and Trump can point at Obama until his fingers fall off, but that isn't going to change the fact that it's him and not his predecessor who kowtows to the Kremlin's every wish. Because the only one who's being outsmarted by Putin is the sole G7 member doing Russia's bidding on an international stage.